Hi everybody, my name's Matthew, I'm a freshman. This is a little impromptu, so forgive me. But when I heard, when Nate asked me to talk about this subject, I was really excited because it's been something that's been sort of difficult for me to reconcile in a lot of ways, because I'm a registered Democrat, and the Democratic Party has a very anti-life platform. And so I've thought a lot about how to create a convincing apologetic for the pro-life cause in the context of progressivism. And I really think that this method, this lens of looking at the issue as a consistent life ethic from birth to death is the key. Because if we're going to say that we need to bring in refugees, we need to take care of the poor, we need to make sure that there's a sufficient social safety net, then that perspective should go to the very beginning of life. That violence in any context is wrong, and that if a society is marked by its care of the least, and I think that in America especially, the least in our society are the unborn. And if we're not taking care of the unborn and preserving their rights, we really can't say we're preserving anybody's rights. So that's just my quick introduction. So thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Allie Burton. Last year I was the vice president of Princeton Pro-Life. I'm very excited to be here. I think one way that my perspective on being pro-life has evolved is that I've started to think of myself as more of what's called whole life, in that, I don't just care about saving the unborn, but also when they get here, that they have a full and thriving life, and thinking about ways that we can do that without just being it on a conservative side or a liberal side, and how what's the best way to do that, and thinking how we can bring people together, because in a lot of ways this issue tends to be very divisive, which is kind of disheartening, because I think that at the core of it, we all really do care about people. Whether you're pro-life or pro-choice, I see a lot of concern for people in general. And so that's what I hope we can gain from this today, is how we can all take our love for each other and humanity and come up with ways to promote a consistent life ethic, regardless of your position.
Well, thanks for being here this morning. I am proud to be a Latina alum, class of 2000. I am the daughter of two Mexican immigrants, and with my husband, we're the very lucky parents of six. And like a lot of Hispanics in America, I am strongly pro-life with strong pro-immigrant convictions. The Latino vote is not a monolith. There is a lot of diversity among Latinos on the abortion issue, just as there is among other groups. But there is evidence that Hispanic women like myself tend to be more pro-life than our white or black sisters. The Relationships in America survey found that Hispanic women in America were about twice as likely to dispute abortion rights as they were to support them. And a survey by the Public Religion Research Institute reported that 54% of Hispanic millennials believe that abortion should be illegal in most or all cases. Because so many of us American Hispanics have this strong pro-life bent, it also puts us in a rather uncomfortable position politically, seeing that the pro-life party in this country is currently led by somebody with a strongly xenophobic tone with anti-immigration tendencies. In this last election, with all the talk about building a wall, we pro-life Hispanics were put in this very uncomfortable position. Many of us felt that we had to choose between defending the unborn and defending our skin, the skin on our backs and our fellow immigrants. So a lot of us had to ask, should America be a safe space for the unborn, or should it be a safe space for immigrants? And the answer, of course, has to be both. A coherent pro-life position is based on the profound, inherent, equal dignity of every member of the human family. The same heart and principles that make me unconditionally pro-life also make me pro-immigration, pro-refugee. This pro-life position is discernible by understanding the truths of biology. You know, the science is very clear here. Embryologists tell us that each one of us begins as a single zygote, as a fertilized egg. At that point, we are genetically distinct human organisms, a genetic unity. From that moment of fertilization, we have a complete set of chromosomes that direct our internal functioning. These are scientific facts. But then we have to kick in moral reasoning and decide how we respond to those scientific facts. As a political philosopher, I know that the only sound philosophy is one that sees all human beings as having equal dignity, whether it's the child in the womb, or the person who's cognitively disabled, or the frail elderly suffering from Alzheimer's, or the undocumented immigrant, or the Muslim refugee. This understanding of the human person is the very foundation for the concept of human rights. We have rights not in virtue of some attainment or some achievement, or how beautiful somebody is, or what they look like, or how far along they get in school, but in virtue of our very humanity. So in a few minutes, I'll come back and talk about some actionable recommendations, but now I'll turn it over to Professor Londregan.
Okay, well, thanks for showing up this morning. So there's a lot of heat generated over this issue of pro-life and pro-choice and so forth. If you strip away the arguments from the surface and get down to what's sort of really, really at stake, it's the question of who's a human being. If you recast a lot of the arguments made by the pro-choice people, as arguments not for abortion but for infanticide, they immediately sound ghoulish. If it's a question of, well, you know, we could abort the child now and that will enable us to have a happier child many years later, well, try that out as, we'll kill our two-year-old now and then have another one down the road when we're better off. Won't that be good? Wait a minute. So as soon as you recognize the humanity of the person who's being killed in an abortion, it's suddenly, I think the debate ends. So in some very fundamental sense, you know, that's what it's about. There is the sort of popular notion that, well, I'm pro-life, but I'm also pro-choice. Leave this up to people's consciences. So what about the human rights activist who says, yes, I'm in favor of human rights, but it, far be it from me to stand between a police interrogator's conscience and a rubber hose. Well, or the environmentalist. Yes, I want cleaner water, but far be it from me to impose on the chemical manufacturer what they put into the river. So, again, the notion of pro-choice and pro-life eventually forces you to make a choice about whether you defend life or not. Now, there is the question of who's a human being and what's a life worth living. There's a lot of discussion. My distinguished colleague Peter Singer has made a half of a career out of talking about some human lives not being worth living. My general rule of thumb is that it's a bad idea to commit plagiarism, and if you were going to plagiarize somebody, don't plagiarize Hitler. So the Nazis had a whole line about lives unworthy of being lived. And look where that led. So there's an old story about 2.5 generations, and after 2.5 generations we forget some of the visceral lessons that were learned by history. It is forgotten that before the Nazis even came to power, Weimar Germany was very pro-abortion. And then, after the discovery of what had happened during the Holocaust, everyone sort of stepped back and was aghast for a while. But we're forgetting that. Moreover, in the 40-some years since Roe versus Wade, people have gotten unfortunately comfortable with the idea of abortion and the idea of taking a life. And psychologically, there's a kind of Gutman scale. Psychologists use the term Gutman scale, but we can think about there being a unidimensional scale of resistance to ideas or respect for life. And as people have grown more comfortable with abortion, they have also become more comfortable with infanticide, with quote-unquote euthanasia of the elderly. I don't see the eudaimonic part of euthanasia, but that idea has now gained extra respectability because, I think in part, we've become coarsened by 40-some years of quote-unquote safe legal abortion. I, again, don't see what's safe about it. So there's a danger that if we continue down this current road, it won't just be abortion that's happening. There will be a more pervasive decay of the culture of life, a more pervasive lack of concern for others and for the coherence of our society. I think a lot of people wish that they could find some sort of status quo and just hide from this issue because it's so contentious. The one thing I'm sure of is that the status quo won't continue. We will either see diminished respect for life and increasingly cavalier use of killing. Think about drone strikes around the world. People seem remarkably at home with that. Or we'll see some rolling back and some recognition that, well, almost everybody recognizes that last trimester abortions are very troublesome. Perhaps we'll start seeing legislation against those that's upheld constitutionally. The constitutional rationale for Roe v. Wade was weak indeed, whatever one thinks of the merits, of the underlying merits of the case. So that brings us, of course, to the tenor of the current debate. It is often the case that when you run out of substantive arguments, you substitute ad hominem arguments. Oh, this or that person is on the wrong side of this or that other debate, therefore they must be wrong on abortion. And in the end, the abortion debate will go away when there's a consensus. When people across the political spectrum agree on a particular point of view, it becomes the consensus view of human rights. And that's going to involve a lot of people changing their positions, and it's going to involve a lot of people who disagree about other things coming to agree about the value of life. Now, I suppose that brings up the sort of key arguments made by pro-choice people about liberty and freedom, and, well, isn't it the case that an unwanted life imposes a burden on the mother? And isn't it disproportionately falling on women? Isn't this whole notion that abortion should be banned easy for men to talk about because it's women who do the heavy lifting when it comes to bringing children into the world? Turns out, it's also women, and by the way, people of color, who are disproportionately aborted. It's not women, of course, but women as fetuses. It's female fetuses, girls, who are aborted disproportionately. There's sex-selective abortion going on all the time. And we might not like that, but that's the choice that people are making. Now, if we look at any other aspect of life, if we saw the kind of disproportion that we do in abortion, the Justice Department would be going ballistic. Here's some undertaking that's way disproportionately taking the lives of females and people of color. Well, here in abortion, somehow that debate gets short-circuited. And yes, it's true that having a child when one isn't ready for it does pose a disproportionate benefit on, disproportionate burden upon women. But then, so does child raising. If a mother has a small child at home, and her husband decides to disappear, or her significant other decides to disappear, there she is raising the child. We look for lots of solutions to that, but we don't look to infanticide as the way to resolve the problem. And there's no reason that we should be reaching so readily for abortion. The idea that we are a collection of cells developing along surprisingly human lines until we're born, and then sacred life, the moment we're born, strikes me as a kind of shamanistic view of biology. There is some sort of mystical belief that sustains this dichotomy between collection of cells at one moment and human at the next. That's not the way it actually works. So, I'm looking forward to an interesting discussion. I would say sort of one more thing in closing. Once somebody's been through an abortion, it changes them. And it's a very painful experience, it's a very difficult experience, and it doesn't behoove pro-life people to throw too many stones. We're all living in one kind of glass house or another, and better we don't condemn those who made choices we disapprove of. Far better that we recognize that the past is prologue and that we can do better tomorrow. And to have some compassion for people who've been through the wrenching experience of having an abortion. So, I think Anna has a few more words that she, Dr. Samuel has a few more words that she would like to share.
Okay, so just on the action side of things, I would just make two broad actionable recommendations. One would be that we have greater informed consent for young women. Several studies have found that the vast majority of women who've undergone abortions, some studies say as high as 81%, feel that they've been victimized by the abortion process. They were withheld information that they should have known about. And every young woman really should have what you might call an abortion safety checklist. She needs to know what kind of long-term medical risks she's incurring. Much higher risk for placenta previa, premature birth of babies if she does get pregnant down the line, suicide ideation, she's at much higher risk for mental distress. She needs to know all those things as part of her informed consent decision. So this involves going down to university clinics and asking what is being given to the young women so that they can think. Yes, do you want to jump in right now?
Sorry, maybe I didn't hear it. Where was the, which poll was that?
Yes, so it was a 1992 study from the Journal of Social Issues. And I can, if you come up to me after the talk, I can give you a paper where it has it. Good, and then the second broad thing I would vouch for is that we support local pregnancy shelters and pro-life centers. There are about 12 that I counted pro-life pregnancy centers in New Jersey. I'm told that Choice One in Trenton is probably the closest one. We need to have a pregnancy support place for alums or for undergraduates. I would love to see a network of young women, Princeton undergrads, who decided to keep their baby. I personally know of two young women who were undergrads, got pregnant, decided to keep the child. I would love to see a group of alums come out and show why they're so happy they kept the child. That would be very inspiring, I think. So support these women some more. And great, so we'll open it up to your thoughts and questions now.
Should we maybe sit like on the other side of one of these tables so that
yeah.
You can sort of
yeah.
See us?
Sure.
Here.
I guess I could go 1, 2, and 3.
You want to go ahead first?
Yeah.
Yes.
I read
Clutter. Hi. I've heard a lot of discussion about the rights of the unborn, but almost no discussion about the rights of the individual carrying this fetus. And I've heard people sort of allude to the idea that, like, that the other side is using the argument about women or people who carry fetus as being disproportionately responsible for raising that child. But that's the claim there, I believe, is a rights claim, not like it's a claim about the autonomy of the physical body carrying the child, the fetus, right? So can we discuss that? Like, is there, like, I've not heard a single satisfactory counterpoint to this. Like, if a person is carrying this fetus, it's a, without their continued assent and consent, it's a continued assault on their physical autonomy. And I really like to discuss, like, I've not met very many pro-life people, so I've really not gotten a chance to hear about this, but, like, that is, like, deeply troubling to me. And I think what is actually at the crux of this, like, I think it is a physical autonomy rights concern.
Well, so rights have a sort of axiomatic all or nothing flavor to them. And here, you're weighing something that's obviously a deeply personal compromise of one's autonomy against the life and death of another individual. And if we use the language of rights, I think we're always going to get it wrong. If we talk about an unambiguous right to autonomy, etc., an unambiguous right to freedom, we have to weigh that against the right to life. And I'm not claiming, I don't think any reasonable pro-life person claims that that's an easy choice to weigh. No one claims that this is a picnic for women or that it doesn't impinge upon them. The question is, should we go to the lengths of being willing to kill someone in order to affirm the autonomy of another individual, given that the pregnancy process isn't a permanent one, and given that it is a part of our natural life cycle?
Yeah. If I could just respond to you quickly. I mean, I'm very sympathetic to the idea that women have rights during all of this. I think I would start the conversation with you by reflecting more on what consent means. Yeah, I think you said that word like 4 times. And what it means for a woman to consent to something that's happening to her. We don't get to consent about everything, right? I don't get to consent about whether I'm aging. I'm going to age whether I want to or not, right? And so I think it's worth exploring what things can we consent over and what things can't we consent over. Once, if I've engaged in sex and I've consented to it and I have an accidental pregnancy, I think that falls very well under my own consent. I mean, I've consented to that situation. I might not be happy about the consequences of it, but I would say that I consented to it. Would you disagree?
That's a big if, right?
So if what?
We know that consent is a really fuzzy area for people. People do not fully understand it, right?
Yeah, well, okay, well, we can...
People are raped all the time, right?
All right, fair enough. Fair
huge
enough.
Problem.
Yeah, fair enough. But, I mean, even in this, okay, let's just assume the worst case scenario. Let's just assume that rape situation, all right? Which is, of course, one of the most horrific I could ever imagine myself in. I've spoken to my husband, actually. We've had conversations about this where I say to him, I prefer to be shot, frankly, than raped. I can't imagine the psychological toll of a woman in that situation, all right? And I'm very sympathetic to this horrific case where, I mean, I've been pregnant 6 times, I've had children, and it's not easy to be pregnant. And I can't imagine the psychological turmoil of having a child but from a rapist, right? So I don't want to lessen in any way the very tragic situation that the woman is in there. But I think it would be worse for her to turn around and then become a murderer. In other words, there's no easy way out of this situation. But I think that now she's stepping outside of this case where she's been the victim. And now she's stepping into the shoes of the person who's, right, killing someone else. That's how I see it. So, yeah.
I think it's also important to consider when we start when the cutoff point is. I mean, would you say that a child at 9 months in its mother's womb is can be aborted?
I think a cutoff point is kind of irrelevant to what she was saying.
Well, no, in terms of viability. I mean, it is relevant because, if we're going to say that, abortion is a right, when does it cease to be a right?
Well, I don't think she was saying that. Correct me if I'm wrong, but what I heard from your argument was that the issue of once if you concede that the fetus represents a human life and is going into a potential human being, this doesn't make the moral calculus just black and white.
Right, but when does that individual's bodily autonomy supersede the right of one's own bodily autonomy?
Right, I think that's the question that you're saying, is that that there's the bodily autonomy of someone else is being affected. I think it has less to do with how old the fetus is. Because I think she concedes that a fetus will become a child at some point, left alone, right? And if you want to concede that.
But does it become a child at birth, or does it become a child at viability? What is the cutoff point?
I think this is the problem with this whole sort of lexicographic rules being applied. I mean, if you really believe that continued consent is necessary, so the person who, say, signs up for the armed forces and then goes out and then halfway through their enlistment decides, you know what, I don't want to be in the armed forces anymore, now I'm a slave. Well, we wouldn't quite say that, no, the 13th Amendment has been violated here. No. They consented to join the armed forces. They knew that there would be hardships and they might change their minds. So I think we really do have to wonder about this notion of ongoing consent. And one way to test how strongly you believe it is to say, the day before you're going to give birth, you change your mind, you consented to the pregnancy, you wanted the pregnancy, you changed your mind on the last day, and now you don't want it, and now it's an invasion. And you're going to have birth tomorrow. Do you still have a right to abort today because your autonomy has been violated by your changing your mind? I mean, if you really believe that continued volition is required, it's certainly the case that on the last day of pregnancy, it's a very invasive thing. Do you still think it's okay to have that abortion? Or would you say, wait, there are other considerations to weigh against the autonomy right?
There were some people waiting. I can't remember who it was. Were you next? I think I can yell. Were you next? Yeah.
Thank you for coming. And I wanted to ask if you could comment on the role of providing birth control to women. So to prevent the case of unwanted children, abortions, period. I think it's a very related issue.
I mean, I think... this is a hairy one for me. I think, yes, I mean, I think that providing birth control is part of a good public policy generally. However, we have to distinguish between, I mean, not all birth control is the same, and a lot of them are abortifacients, the ones that prevent implantation. So it is a life issue as well. So I would be very cautious about deciding between what kinds of, contraception are promoted under what information.
I mean, I think there's a heterogeneity of opinion amongst pro-life people, and some pro-life people who are motivated by religious teachings might take a more doctrinaire position and say no birth control at all. Others of us would be perfectly happy to say, yeah, let's be prudent here and take all available measures to protect life, but also to protect autonomy. And when you can do both at the same time, so much the better.
Something that has been bothering me a bit. So I grew up in Europe, in France, and I came here about 8 months ago when I started to be mixed into this whole debate. And there's one aspect of it that I think that the debate is being framed in the wrong way. It's something you hear when you hear the vocabulary that it's used. You talk about murder, about infanticide, whereas the person over there was talking about terminating a fetus. So I think the question really boils down to something that you've touched on a little bit and that came up here, is to what is a human being? I think it makes, an argument that you've made several times is right before birth, there must be continuity. But the same argument applies to the other side. right after fertilization, why would a fertilized ovum be any more of a human than any random skin cell? Right? So the question, I think, really is, where do you put the cutoff? Right? So it seems to me that it's not a rational argument to say that if you have an abortion in the first trimester, that you're killing a human being. That is the essential, the crux of the issue, is that I don't think that, so the pro-choice, which is probably a bad word for what the movement actually represents, does not support murder. It supports something else that is not that at least the people who are pro-choice don't believe is a murder.
Well, they may not believe it's a murder, but I mean, to not put a fine point on it, a lot of people who participated in the Holocaust didn't think they were committing murder because they didn't think they were killing human beings. They were wrong.
But there's a very much stronger argument for why human being, a Jewish human being, is a human being,
right,
than people,
so,
a bunch of cells.
So, first of all, it's interesting that you come from the perspective of France, because the abortion issue got decided through filtered through the political process somewhat differently in France. It was in fact decided more democratically through the representative process. And in France, you have cooling off periods, you have various measures that soften the blow. There's still the question about whether abortion should be allowed at all. But in France, the policy was set very differently. Here it was set by judicial ukase. The Supreme Court hands down a sort of bright line decision that says it's against our fundamental document to ever inhibit abortion. And that's a very extreme position that sort of placed itself right in the middle of our political decision process, and it shaped all of our discussion about it since then in this country. How could it not?
Right, but is the appropriate response to such a radical decision by the judiciary to take the opposite radical position, which is to ban all of abortion?
So certainly not because the judiciary did it. We can have a discussion on the merits about the questions you raise, and lots of reasonable people disagree about what you do during the first trimester. There's a logical, consistent argument that says, all right, let's look at when it's okay to terminate a pregnancy. And once you accept that the fetus is alive, the fact that it's not conscious at the moment that you terminate no longer has much weight. We would say, if somebody was in surgery, unconscious, anesthetized, we wouldn't say it's all right to kill them
right then.
Yeah,
I would debate the humanity of the
so that's
first
the question.
Trimester fetus.
So then the issue is, if nature takes its course, the person on the operating table will recover. In fact, it requires medical intervention for them to come back, typically.
Okay.
Whereas the fetus would just naturally come to be
waiting,
a person.
There's a lot of people waiting, so I'm just going to, I think you've been waiting for a while. The first one in the glass is ivory shirt.
I have a few comments for the professor. I guess, like, first, in the interest of respectful discussion, could I ask for a stop to the arguments by arguments to Hitler?
You discussed the Holocaust.
Yeah.
That's a comparison.
I did.
Yes.
I'm not sure there's disrespect. The first time you brought
it up, you just stated it as something that the Nazis did abortion, which like the Nazis did lots of things, like Hitler was a vegetarian. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't seem to contribute anything. I have a question. You mentioned earlier on that abortions are disproportionately done to female unborn children.
Right.
Is that in the United States?
Less so here, but it's also here.
How much?
So it depends by ethnicity and so forth, but if you look at birth ratios, I don't know the numbers off the top of my head for the US, but there are disproportionately many boys born, especially in certain social classes and ethnicities.
Well,
Can we find those numbers somewhere?
Yes.
More so than natural?
Yeah.
Thank you. And lastly, you asked, or lastly, you made the point that if abortion is permitted, that paves the way for a further degradation in, like, I guess, society's overall respect to life. That sounds like a slippery slope argument to me. Is there any mechanism is there some concrete reason to believe that causation would happen?
Well, it's an intuition about psychology coupled with the empirical reality that there are euthanasia laws now in Oregon and in other places that would have been unthinkable 50 years ago. Those laws didn't exist 50 years ago. Perhaps it's simply a coincidence that with the widespread prevalence of legal abortion, we are now also talking very calmly about euthanizing the elderly and inconvenient.
Just to jump to this side of the room. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you, everyone, that came out into the comments so far. I'm Patrick, a graduate student in the philosophy department. I work on ethics. So there's a lot of things I wanted to touch on, but I thought a good place to start would be what the scope of the pro-life position is. As I hear it coming from y'all, you believe that in every case, abortion is impermissible. It is morally forbidden. And so we would only need a single instance, a single case where it's permissible for that to be proven false. And so we can take what many pro-life people would describe as a worst case scenario. So it's the first trimester, we have overwhelming evidence that the zygote cannot develop into a infant. We know that if carried to term, it will result in the death of the mother, right? And this was the result of rape. That is the kind of case that someone who really defends the unqualified right to life across the spectrum needs to defend.
No, and I this is a fairly easy one to answer, because in the cases where it's scientifically certain, I mean beyond doubt, that the mother will die, most pro-lifers will say that there you can save the life of the mother, even if the child is killed.
So let's abstract that criterion. That's fine.
Yeah.
If you're already going to grant me that, then that's fine. Let's just move to the slightly different piece.
Sure.
There's a 50-50 risk, right, that the mothers will die.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I don't know that it's ever that clear that it's maybe a 50-50 risk. I think that saving the life of the mother, you know, hoping as much as possible to try to save the child as well, would be the best route there, morally, I would say, as a philosopher. But you know what really happens in real life, and I speak here because I now have two friends who carried to term a child who they knew was going to die in the delivery room. It was a child, one of them, the brain wasn't developing properly, the other one wasn't going to be able to breathe outside the uterus. And they were, I mean, the onslaught of providers who told them to abort, why keep carrying the child, right? One of them is a Princeton alum, actually, Katrina. She's been very open about her story. Usually what happens in real life is that the mother is pressured to abort, even though she wants to respect this child's life, right? So I think in your hard cases, absolutely, save the life of the mother. But let's just really make sure that that's the only way to save the life of the mother. That would be my bottom line.
In general, there is not an obligation that we put on people to save those that are around them. I see someone that's in traffic and I worry that there's a good chance that they're going to get hit by an oncoming truck, and I may well lose a limb if I try to save them. Most people, not Peter Singer, most people think that I am not required to put myself in substantial risk to save an adult human being, right? And we, for many individuals, carrying a fetus to term imposes similar burdens and similar risks to running into traffic to save an adult human being.
Well, but most people would agree that we don't have a license to kill someone else. And with abortion, at least at the moment it happens, you are actually taking another life. In terms of the hard cases,
to no longer provide life-saving care to this person.
So in terms of the hard cases you bring up, I think the parallel are to conjoined twins. So it's often the case that people are born with conjoined to their twin. And the doctors have really hard choices to make about how to care for that pair, that conjoined pair. And sometimes the medical decisions they make involve extinguishing the life of one of the conjoined twins. But there, both twins are recognized as human. In the case of abortion, we're talking about a human being and a parasite. That's the current state of the law. And I would argue that you don't even have to be strongly pro-life to think that that legal fiction leads to bad decisions.
Just to clarify, doctors intentionally end the lives of their patients very often in the United States, not in euthanasia. There are people that have untreatable pain conditions for which they are prescribed barbiturates, which render them unconscious and cause respiratory arrest.
That's euthanasia.
I just
want to
know there's about five minutes left in this session.
Pardon?
There's only about 5 minutes left.
Okay, we should have more questions.
Yeah, go ahead, jump in.
Yeah, so I really appreciate what you talked about with like consistent life method. I do think it's a very kind of strong criticism of the pro-life movement that it tends to be like, you know, what they call pro-birth or like not taking care of life afterwards. I'm like trying to look at sort of like the sources of this and how to remedy that. One thing I noticed is that, like, actually, so I'm from Japan, and, you know, I spent some time with Nagasaki and Hiroshima, and it's, like, when I talk to people about nuclear, like, the nuclear bomb, like, often it's the liberals who are like, oh, yeah, that's totally wrong. And it's often, like, the conservative pro-life people who are like, well, you know, like, it was justified because it saved these lives later down the line. And I just think it's so interesting that you have, like, this consequentialist argument kind of, like, filtering through, even in, like, people who call themselves pro-life. And like, how can you be pro-life if you think that in order to like somehow avert a later bad effect, you can like incinerate civilians, right? So like, what would you say to like pro-life people to like encourage them to have a more sort of holistic, like whole life?
I think it was interesting you bring it, because I was actually having a conversation about that exact topic with somebody else last week, and I think one thing is to think about, is to get them to think about, why do you value life so much? And then, like, because it's not just enough to say that, like, that people should have a right to life. Like, people also need to have, like, I think people also have the right to have, like, fulfilling lives, not just, like, lives where, like, they've been forgotten. I think that we need to talk about, like, you know, like, you can't just say, like, it's important for everyone to have a right to life and then say, like, well, I don't care what happens to you later. You know, like, if you really do care about life, then it has to be more than just, like, in the cases of abortion. It has to be, you know, it has to be, like, when we're talking about things like dropping an atom bomb, like, that's, yeah, the death penalty, euthanasia, all these other things, it's because it's, life is so much more than just at the beginning, you know, like, there's the rest of it too. And I think it is kind of a struggle a lot of times having that conversation with people, because sometimes they're just like, I think it's gotten so wrapped up in politics, and particularly like with the pro-life issue, it's gotten so tied into like Republican politics that sometimes people haven't necessarily thought about what it means to be pro-life beyond just like abortion. So I think a lot of it is just getting people to think outside of the box of like where politics has put us with this conversation.
Last word? In the back, yeah.
Oh, so I just feel kind of uncomfortable being like the fifth guy in the room to talk about abortion. But I just from a scientific perspective, I might argue that maybe one, or I might submit that maybe one definition of what a human life is in terms of their embryo is more like, if that thing was removed from the mother and given full supply of oxygen and milk, like, could it survive on its own for more, or could it eventually develop into like an adult, you know, toddler for like after 48 hours, right? So if you take sort of a 8 cells zygote out of a mother and you put it, you know, in the petri dish and you know, given all the oxygen the milk it needs, can eventually develop into a person. And in that case, it's no, right? So for me, that is sort of like that is a, for me, that is a sort of hard line definition of what a human life is.
So,
or else,
so this, you raise really interesting, a really interesting question here. My brother-in-law is a pediatrician in Chile, and he tells me that so they can basically save fetuses past a certain point, right? If you're born premature children, that is. So he deals with prematurely born children in a big public hospital in Chile, and they can save children past a certain point. And he told me matter-of-factly, you know, if these children had been born in the United States, we could have saved them a month earlier with the technology that you've got in the U.S. But we can't do it here. Now, I'm uncomfortable with the definition of life that depends on your latitude and longitude and on the quality of the respirator at the hospital where you happen to be born.
Well, I'm more okay with that.
I'm going to pause the discussion here because we're out of time and the room needs to be clear for the next session. You're free to continue your conversation from the lobby.
Thank you.